talk about the filtration again going on in the kidneys. Now, remember that this happens across the wall of the glomerulus, right? Like any other capillary, it's a simple squamous epithelial layer. You've also got the fenestra. It's a tiny little holes in between the cells. You got the basement membrane, which you find around most epithelial tissue. And then you got these podocytes, these other little epithelial cells that surround the capillary. So looking back up at this filtration membrane, it is a barrier. It's going to hold back the big things in the blood. All the large things like the cells and the proteins are valuable. You don't want to ever see those being lost out of the body in the urine. So all those little tiny holes and other spaces will hold those larger materials back. It's a simple mechanical filter, just like you find in many other devices. Keep them from ever going into the Bowman's capsule. They don't even have to be reabsorbed by the rest of the nephron. So it is more permeable than a typical capillary because of all the little holes, but it still holds back most all the large structures. Looking at the filtration pressure, well, if you think about the pressure that pushes material out of that glomerulus capillary, that's the pressure generated by the left ventricle. So it shoves blood out the aorta. Some of that blood is going to reach the renal arteries, and of course, that'll lead to these smaller capillaries. Looking at the forces that affect movement of fluid in and out of the lumen, that's the inside of that Bowman's capsule, you get three different pressures to consider here. One being the glomerular capillary pressure. Now that's the outflow pressure. That's the pressure being generated by the left ventricle. Pushes this blood, which is largely fluid, into that capillary, and of course it passes out through all those tiny little holes and into the Bowman's capsule. Now looking at that Bowman's capsule, there's a pressure inside of it that's pushing against that glomerular capillary pressure. There's a certain amount of water, right? And that's largely what it is. Plasma's mostly water to start with, and you hold back even more of the solutes behind that capillary. Well, what gets through it and into that Bowman's capsule is mostly water. So that water's trying to push back, right? Definitely got some capsule pressure in that lumen, which again, is just the inside of that capsule. Then you also got this blood colloid osmotic pressure. You figure as what's mostly fluid is forced through those holes out of that glomerulus, you're left with far more solutes and less water in that blood that's in that capillary. So, of course, that's a pull back on that water. Osmosis tells you that water wants to move from high to low concentration. So if you look at these three pressures, that outflow pressure is around 50 millimeters mercury. That capsule pressure generated by the water already in it is about 10. That's working against it. And then the colloid, all these solutes pulling back on that water is another 30. So if you look at the difference between the two, 50 minus 10 minus 30, it's only an outflow pressure of 10 millimeters mercury pressure. You don't have to change the pressure much inside of that glomerulus to change how much filtration pressure you're going to get. In other words, how much filtrate you'll make and how much urine you'll make. So look at that filtration. Think about some things which might affect it, like glomerular nephritis. You get an inflammation, a swelling of these glomeruli, well, that's going to make those little holes and spaces bigger. Solutes are going to start to get through them that couldn't before, and water's going to follow. That's going to cause more water to move into the nephrons. That's going to make more filtrate, probably making more urine, and you're going to see a lot of things being lost that you should not be losing. But look at what that high pressure inside that glomerulus comes from. There's low resistance on the inflow. That's the afferent arterioles. Remember, the number one thing that affects resistance is the radius, the size of the blood vessel. So low resistance tells you got a larger radius on the inflow. You've got high resistance, meaning a smaller radius on the outflow. So with a big blood vessel leading into that capillary and a smaller one on the way out, that creates pressure inside that glomerulus and gives you a lot of that outflow pressure. Now, if you look at that second capillary that picks up so much of this filtrate, the peritubular, the pressure in it downstream is lower. So with a higher pressure in the glomerulus, a lot of material is coming out, lower pressure in the second peritubular downstream, more stuff's going back in. And that's exactly what you're trying to do, get most all of this filtrate right back into that second capillary. So that filtrate's forced across that membrane into the nephron. First, the Bowman's capsule, then the rest of the parts of the nephron do the reabsorption. As they reabsorb that filtrate, it goes right back into the interstitial fluid and right back into that pericapillary network. And the body can rapidly change how much filtrate is being made by changing the radius of that afferent and efferent arteriole. If you want to look at diameter, same thing. Think about what would happen if you dilated, made the afferent larger. That's increasing the inflow and at the same time constricting the efferent, which is the outflow. With more blood coming in and the outflow getting smaller, gives you more capillary pressure in that glomerulus. You're going to make more filtrate. You can make more urine. You could also do just the opposite. Constrict the afferent. Make your inflow smaller. And then you make that outflow larger. That would decrease the pressure. And less filtrate would be made at that time right there. And think about how the sympathetic and parasympathetic divisions of the nervous system would affect this blood flow. Again, that sympathetic division with its epinephrine and norepinephrine is released at the time of physical activity, things such as that. Well, it's then you want to send more blood to heart, lungs, skeletal muscles. You got to pull it from somewhere. And since there's a very large amount of blood going to your kidneys, that's a good place to pull it from. So constrict all this blood flow going into the kidneys. You'll get less of it, less filtrate being made at that time. You're going to hold on to that water, helping to keep that pressure up, which is what you need at this time. Think about times like hypovolemic shock. Maybe somebody's losing blood. And at that time, you certainly wouldn't want to lose anything else out of the blood, like that filtrate formation coming from that plasma. So if your blood pressure drops, you're definitely going to send a lot less blood to the kidneys to hold on to that water. You'll worry about waste removal at another time. So at that time, you can see that filtrate formation dropping way down to very little. With the parasympathetic, when somebody's relaxed and resting and such, well, now you don't need a large amount of blood going to heart, lungs, skeletal muscles. At that time, you can afford to send more to the kidneys, dilating all those afferent arterioles, increasing the blood flow, making more filtrate, and, of course, getting more urine formation and waste removal at that time. So here's your pictures again with the inflow and the outflow. There's the capillary, the glomerulus in the center. You dilate this afferent, constrict that afferent. That's more coming in, less going out, a greater pressure, forces more fluid, making more filtrate to be formed. Well, you can do more of everything the nephrons need with this reabsorption and getting rid of materials you want out of the body. Just the opposite with that blood flow would hold true also.